tiny villages on Mud Island, just off the coast of Papua New Guinea. Saibai, Boigu and Duan mark Australia's only international border with another country. 40 years ago, there was outrage in the Torres Strait as these islanders faced being stripped of their Australian citizenship to become Papua New Guineans.
There were people that keep mentioning to me about didn't know where Torres Strait was. And I can understand if their feeling at that time was, yeah, there was only a group of islands there, let's divide it, you know. And so until they actually had that uprising in the sense of the protest by us, by our people.
The late George Mai led the so-called Border Not Change protests.
We can't let Australia go because they owed us too much. They cleaned our place out of our resources.
Once valuable pearl shell, trochus and bêche de mer industries motivated colonial occupation.
In 1879, Queensland annexed the whole of the Torres Strait and about 300 islands, including Saibai, which is only a few kilometres from the Papua New Guinean mainland that you can see in the distance behind me here. That set the scene for a showdown 100 years later.
In the 1960s, proposed PNG independence led to the inevitable question of what happened to the Torres Strait colonial border.
Papua New Guinea government was saying that we will take some of the Torres Strait islands, like Saibai is one.
Gaetano Louis Jr. was a young island councillor when the dispute flared.
When PNG received their independence under international law, obviously that they were entitled to the continental shelf.
Gough Whitlam was elected prime minister in 1972, promising the strait would be split in half and up to nine islands transferred to PNG. There was no consultation with the islanders. But Whitlam faced a formidable foe, one who revelled in attacking the Labor Party.
You're people of the sea, not of the land. The sea is just as important to you as the land of the island itself.
Sir Joe Bjelke-Petersen was renowned for his staunch opposition to Aboriginal land rights.
It's got to be stopped, this land rights business and continually giving away the nationals' assets.
At stake in the Torres Strait, 25,000 square kilometres of Queensland territory. In 1973, Bjelke-Petersen assembled the media for a trip to the islands that Whitlam had never visited.
He wanted to take us all up there and have them, have us see and tell the rest of Australia about the huge welcome he's receiving from all these islanders who think he's almost like he was a god.
Bjelke-Petersen's campaign stalled Whitlam, and the issue was unresolved when he was dismissed in 1975. His successor, Malcolm Fraser, decided to keep all the islands, but with a twist, and again faced a familiar opponent.
Island leaders are still deeply concerned over the border issue with Papua New Guinea. They have been informed by the federal government that they can live on their islands, but they must give up their seas.
Fraser visited the islands to sell his plan.
Torres Strait Islands are the only part of Australia that is interfacing on a foreign country. And that's something we've got up our sleeves. We're proud of it.
In 1978, Australia and PNG signed the Torres Strait Treaty, leaving almost everything as it was. Today, not everyone is happy with the outcome.
I would honestly say no, because I was not educated. I didn't know really what was happening.
But the treaty did give the islanders and 13 PNG coastal villages unprecedented recognition of their traditional rights.
The things that we asked for, we actually got. And if anyone gave us a greater measure of autonomy in Torres Strait, it was Joe.
Whatever Bjelke-Petersen's motivations, the federal government's redrawing of a line on a map ended with Torres Strait Islanders' place in Australia being secured with an international treaty.